Good evening. For those of you I don't know, I am so proud and happy to welcome all of you. I am Jennifer Rabb and have the great privilege of being the president of Hunter College. And to welcome all of you to this very special event, which has great significance for all of us here at Roosevelt House, Deborah Solomon's discussion of her new biography of Norman Rockwell's American Mirror. As many of you know, Deb Solomon is one of the nation's leading authorities on art and culture and the author of two previously acclaimed biographies of American artists, Joseph Cornell and Jackson Pollock. And now the critics are showering American Mirror with praise. To cite just one example, the eminent art historian John Wilderming, reviewing it for the New York Times, had this to say. Her challenge was to explain a life utterly different from Rockwell's humorous and optimistic paintings. She has told his story with a breadth of facts and narrative finesse. It is a revelation. This is high praise indeed and ensures this will be a stimulating and informative evening. And there could be no more appropriate place for this discussion than here in Roosevelt House, the New York home of Franklin and Eleanor Roosevelt from soon after they were newlyweds until they moved into the White House. Appropriate because chief among Norman Rockwell's most famous works are the iconic paintings known as the Four Freedoms. And those paintings were inspired by a speech of Franklin Roosevelt's. The speech was his 1941 State of the Union address, and as many of you have noticed, the words that inspired Rockwell are inscribed right in the back of the auditorium. I hope all of you also had a chance during the reception to see the set of Four Freedoms posters that hang here in Roosevelt House. They are the gift of one of Hunter's closest friends and supporters, Leonard Lauder. It was an especially generous gift because Leonard had loved his Four Freedom posters ever since he was a boy during World War II, and they were given to him by his parents. The posters were being sold then to raise money for the war effort, and Leonard's were from the first run. He chose to part with them a few years ago for the very special occasion, the reopening of this house as a public policy institute. And as some of you know, his beloved Evelyn was a Hunter College high school and Hunter College graduate. So this was a very special thing because Evelyn always loved Roosevelt House and she came here as a student and was so much involved with us being able to restore it. She was able to see it restored and knew about this wonderful gift that Leonard had made. Looking back now, it's fascinating to realize that when Roosevelt delivered what has become known as his Four Freedoms speech, it was January of 1941. Nearly a year before the U.S. entered the war. It was a time, however, when Nazi Germany was overrunning Europe and Americans were deeply divided about the nation's response, a divide between those who wanted the U.S. to stay out and those like Roosevelt who understood Americans' involvement was inevitable. FDR's simple but eloquent words were a powerful reminder that there are certain bedrock principles that are worth fighting for. And they inspired many Americans to support the national rearmament the president was leading. Once the U.S. entered the fighting, Norman Rockwell became a strong supporter of the war effort, and it was this that in 1943 brought him to FDR's speech and to the creation of these paintings. When they ran as Saturday Evening Post covers for four consecutive weeks, the magazine was swamped with requests for reprints, and when the paintings were put on tour to sell war bonds, the result was more than $132 million in sales. And we have calculated, Deb, that in today's money, that would be well over $1.5 billion. It's pretty amazing. Deborah Solomon is going to pay special attention this evening to how Rockwell, a deep-dyed Republican, was inspired by the words of a Democratic president, and how he went about creating the four works that have become a permanent part of American iconography. And I hope that maybe you'll even comment on the fact that while also hanging the Four Freedoms posters in the Four Freedoms room, we have put Sarah's poster, a picture, back over the mantle where it always hung on her side of the house. And then we put that lovely picture of Eleanor, one of the most beautiful portraits of Eleanor, across where it hadn't hung, but we thought it would be fun to have them talking to each other. Perhaps as an art historian, you will be able to comment. So it is really just a perfect moment to have you here speaking in this house about Norman Rockwell, about these works, and about a great piece of American history. And before I introduce you, I want to say a special thank you to two members of our audience, Mr. and Mrs. Solomon, who have joined us tonight and Congratulations, you did okay. It is a great pleasure to welcome to Hunter College Deborah Solomon.
Thank you, Jennifer, for that incredible introduction. I feel like I just won an Academy Award. It was so gracious and lovely. And to Bill Goldstein, who helped plan this event tonight. And it's incredibly meaningful for me to speak here, because Roosevelt is very much a part of my book. And interestingly to me, I'm gonna jump right into Roosevelt, if that's okay with you guys. I'm not gonna go with my usual story about how I wrote the book, although we could do that later. It's chaos here already. Okay, when I was researching the Four Freedoms, I looked in every Roosevelt biography to find out if Roosevelt and Rockwell knew one another. And there was no mention of Norman Rockwell in any of the books on Roosevelt. I'm waiting, is there a scholar here? Someone's gonna stand up and say, well, what about, you know, I may have overlooked something. I'm not a Roosevelt scholar. I'm an art historian by training. And I found that fascinating, because Roosevelt was involved with the creation of the paintings. Eleanor Roosevelt helped promote them. And my own feeling is that the Four Freedoms loom so large as principles today in this country, in part, in fact, I would say largely, because Rockwell was able to visualize them for Americans and allow people to, I hate the word relate, but he really allowed Americans to relate to the Four Freedoms. Before he created those posters, patriotic imagery had often consisted of Uncle Sam posters. Remember Uncle Sam, I Want You, the world famous World War I recruiting poster by James Montgomery Flagg. War posters also consisted of images of Lady Liberty in her long gown, in her long Greek gown. There were kind of classic staples of patriotic imagery that went on war posters. Rockwell's brainstorm was to use his neighbors in Vermont as models for the painting and to tell stories that anybody would strike anyone as familiar. So instead of Uncle Sam, for instance, we have just a guy in Vermont who looks a little bit like Abraham Lincoln standing up at a town hall meeting to speak as the elders in the audience give him tremendous respect. And that, of course, we all know is freedom of speech, which might be the best known of the four. Freedom from Want is my personal favorite. It's the Thanksgiving picture with the larger-than-life turkey, perfectly roasted. And I always say I love that painting because no one is giving thanks. It's Thanksgiving, but it's totally free of piety. And I think it really captures the way Americans respect their traditions, but we can laugh at ourselves, too. You know, we don't get very uptight about Thanksgiving. And Thanksgiving is really our greatest non-religious holiday. So I think it was significant that Rockwell became famous for celebrating a holiday that really belongs equally to everyone. Freedom of religion. I never liked that much. And facing in the same direction, which was kind of a radical concept, I find it a little bit airless. Of course, it's not an anecdote like the others. It doesn't take an anecdotal form. And then on the bottom, freedom from fear. Two parents looking in on their sleeping children. It's often described as a painting about parents putting the children to bed, but the children, in fact, are already asleep, and the parents have come in to look in on the children before they go to sleep themselves. And everybody knows the fantastic feeling of well-being that comes from looking in on sleeping children, right? It's a very primitive satisfaction, and I think it's an incredible image for freedom from fear. So the famous story is that when Rockwell first went to the government and proposed these posters, he was turned down. And he was told at the Office of War Information, I'm sorry, you illustrators did the last war, thinking of posters like I Want You, the Uncle Sam, I Want You. This time, he was told, we're going to use real artists. And, you know, in my book, I really go into this chapter, this incident in great detail, because what I found is that the Office of War Information, in fact, tried to bring modern artists in to do war posters. It was, you know, it's one of those really underknown misadventures in American history. I mean, Rockwell was snubbed even by the Office of War Information. Who did they reach out to? You're not going to believe it. Marc Chagall. I love Chagall, but I mean, you know, imagine Chagall doing a recruitment poster. You know, I mean, and then they, Stuart Davis, Salvador Dali, I swear, and Kuniyoshi, a very good artist, but he's Japanese, and this was 6 months, you know, after Pearl Harbor. So Archibald MacLeish, who was kind of overseeing all this at the time, approached these artists. I did find the correspondence in his papers to artists, and none of them submitted poster designs. Why are we not surprised? So none of the modern artists did, okay? And Rockwell was really crushed. He wanted to do something in World War II because he felt like he had kind of botched it in World War I. He had been very young then. A lot of his fellow illustrators made very important posters, such as James Montgomery Flagg, Uncle Sam Wants You. He knew them all. They were all living in New Rochelle and Westchester, but he was very young at the time. He didn't really take it seriously. And he was determined in World War II. It was like just the most important thing to him in the world, to do something valiant. He felt like he had been famous by them for a long time. He became famous at a very early age. He had done the covers for the Saturday Evening Post. He had done, you know, dogs and boys. He was up to his ears in dogs and their mutts. You know, and everyone loved them, but he wanted to do something that would really make a difference to America. And so he pitched the poster. So the government turns them down, right, and instead approaches Marc Chagall, who was living in New York then, of course. And Rockwell decides he wants to illustrate the Four Freedoms anyway. So he does them for the Saturday Evening Post, where he regularly worked. And they ran them not as covers, but inside the magazine, which was very unusual, because usually he did the covers. But instead, each one ran inside on four consecutive weeks, and with a text, an appropriate text, a one-page text. And what I should put in is that the Saturday Evening Post at the time was owned by Curtis Publications, and they were based in Philadelphia. And it was a very conservative magazine. The writers weren't conservative, but the editorial page was, somewhat like the Wall Street Journal today. And the Saturday Evening Post had been picking on Roosevelt and Morgenthau for a long time when Rockwell came in and pitched his posters. And I think one reason that they may have turned him down is they probably didn't want to have to do with the Saturday Evening Post. They hated the Post. The Post was a nightmare. It was always, you know, it was very pro-business, and it accused Roosevelt of being a socialist and opposed all New Deal programs. Rockwell himself was fairly apolitical, was completely apolitical at this point in his career, like a lot of artists. He didn't share the Post politics, but he didn't protest them either. And I think that's why the government may have initially passed on the posters. I've always wondered, is it because a lot of the people working in his information office came from Henry Luce's empire, magazine empire in New York, which was seen as more liberal than Curtis Publications in Philadelphia. So anyway, after Rockwell published the Four Freedoms, the government, the Office of War Information, realized it had made a horrible mistake. And they, you know, tried to figure out who turned these down, what a great idea, these posters to sell the Four Freedoms. And they commissioned Rockwell to do, well, they commissioned the works as posters, basically. And they ran off, at that point, two and a half million posters of the Four Freedoms to be displayed all around the country. They were given out. They were in every store window. You know, when you went to the butcher or where else? Where else did people go? To where? The baker. Wherever you went, the posters were in the window. And they really became, and the American public just fell in love with them because they felt like they suddenly understood what they were fighting for. They suddenly understood that the war wasn't really about killing an enemy, it was about preserving an American way of life. And those posters were believed to define American life more fully than anything that had ever been painted or written. So the public loved them, and then the government decided that they would use them to sell war bonds. So, okay, Morgenthau, Roosevelt's Secretary of the Treasury, was in charge of raising money for the war, and in those days, Americans raised money for their wars. They sold bonds, not like now, where people just say, yeah, go invade that country and you pay for it. So Morgenthau, he was supposed to be very grumpy, and he hated the Saturday Evening Post. So the fact that he agreed to work with them at all on this war bond show that they did together is remarkable. He leaned on the Post. He knew he needed them because they had the largest circulation of any magazine in America at this time, and it offered the government free advertising. Okay? So, in other words, they planned this big For Freedom show. It's going to travel all over the country. It consisted of artwork from the Saturday Evening Post, if you can believe that. It's a strange show, such a sensation. And it filled department stores and traveled around the country for over a year. But this is the way it worked. If you bought a war bond, the prices started at $18, or at $25 after a decade, you got a free set of the Four Freedom posters. So the ones that we saw upstairs, Leonard Lauder's, were the type you acquired. They were that size. They were really nice images. If you spent $18, which of course was a lot, $18.75, thank you, on a war bond. Did you buy one?
Yes.
Excellent. Where are your posters? Long gone. So it was quite incredible that that Roosevelt, who Rockwell was not close to and did not feel connected to, and I think, again, it's because there was this bridge between them called the Saturday Evening Post, which was in many ways, to me, a very odious publication. I mean, when I look back on it now, I think the only thing it really created of lasting value was Norman Rockwell and F. Scott Fitzgerald. It published his earliest short stories in the 20s. But there's not a lot else that we look to the Post for when we look back on magazine history. And what's interesting, of course, is that Rockwell later went on to be associated with liberal politics, because after he was fired from the Post, and they did fire him in 1962, and he didn't advertise that either. He was a very modest person who did not like to pick fights, did not argue publicly with anybody, very much a turn-the-other-cheek type of person. And after he was fired, of course, he went to work for Look magazine, where he did his great civil rights paintings of the 1960s, including The Problem We All Live With, of Ruby Bridges walking to school in New Orleans and desegregating what had been an all-white school. And I find it incredible that somehow he managed to create the defining images of World War II and the defining image of the 1960s. That's pretty cool. And I see them as being related philosophically. I mean, I think he really gave a lot of thought to ordinary Americans and brought ordinary Americans into his work. I mean, in art history, we speak of that as genre painting, scenes of everyday life. But he really perfected that art. And of course, labored on each cover much longer than you might think. He was a very obsessive craftsman and a real perfectionist in the tradition of tortured artists who never want to let their work go and then think it's terrible once it leaves the studio, and really poured himself into those covers. So when I began this project, now I'm getting away from Roosevelt, is it okay? I was somebody, I attended Cornell University and studied art history in the 1970s, and Rockwell's name never came up. He was seen as a lowly illustrator, and we were taught, of course, that Jackson Pollock was the great savior of American painting, and that Jackson Pollock somehow shifted the capital of Paris to New York. That's what we were always told, as if he flew. I always imagined a mythological figure heaving the capital across the oceans to New York. And abstract painting was glorified for a long time, as we all know, and illustration, as well as realist painting and figurative painting, such as the work of Edward Hopper, really had to live in the shadow of abstract painting until fairly recently. I mean, whatever you want to say about postmodernism, which I don't think many people think is an artistic renaissance, it has to be given credit for encouraging art historians and everybody else to realize that history is not linear and that it has been too narrow and we've left out too much in the telling of art and history. And so to me, bringing Rockwell into that history seems like a very natural thing to do. I think that modernism forced us really to define art a little too narrowly for too long. We were too interested in classification. If you read the critics of the 20th century, the great critics like Clement Greenberg on down, they're always obsessed with what is art, what is art? What's high, what's low? Where does George Gershwin fit in? George Gershwin to me is like Rockwell, because there are certain people who really work within the tradition of pop culture but somehow transcend it, and their work remains of interest to us all these years later for inexplicable reasons. And I find it incredible that 35 years after Rockwell's death, his paintings continue to command as much interest as any abstract painting from the 1950s. Because illustration is supposed to be forgotten. Illustration is, you know, like newspaper stories. You do it, it serves a purpose, and then the next week there's a new one, and they're not supposed to endure. And so it's been very gratifying to me to see Rockwell endure and to see our definition of art broadening a lot, I think, in these past few years. Should we move to questions, or does anybody have any questions? Okay. Do you want to say your name?
My name is Bernie Brooks.
Hi, Brody Brooks.
Bernie Gross.
Bernie Gross. Bernie Gross, I see my mother turning around. We had a cousin named Bernie Gross. That can't be you, can it?
I'll tell you where I'm from later, maybe. I was at an odd show about Alan Hirschfeld.
Okay. Yeah. Right. It's interesting too. I see that for those of you who follow the art world, the David Zwirner Gallery is now having an Ad Reinhardt show. Ad Reinhardt, who was famous for his almost all black, supremely modernist canvases. But what are they showing? His cartoons. He was also a cartoonist for PM, the left-wing newspaper, in the 40s. And this is the first time his cartoons have been shown. So, same story. Yes. Sure.
My name is Leslie Getz. I'm curious. I don't know much about Rockwell. Why on earth was he fired from the Post? I mean, his covers were a glory to that magazine. Will you explain that, please?
Yeah. I devoted an entire chapter of my book to it because it was just so outrageous. And also, as somebody who has worked in magazines my entire life, more or less, I thought it was just the ultimate example of magazine foolishness. And anyone who works in magazines has experienced a little bit of the public of a magazine's desire to always be first and be very much aware of what the public is thinking and to ignore everything else that is not suddenly fashionable. And in Rockwell's case, by 1962, it was the 60s, and JFK was president, and the Post decided they were going to modernize. They decided they had to attract a younger audience. That's what I was trying to say. Magazines are always obsessed with the younger demographic. And they thought he just appealed to older readers, some of whom had died off. He did his first cover in 1916. So by the 60s, his readers were disappearing and they were no longer the ones with purchasing power. And the magazine had decided years earlier anyway to put photographs on its cover instead of illustration. Rockwell was interesting because he was able to somehow sustain the golden age of illustration in his own work through the 60s, even though the golden age of illustration, I would say, died off around World War II when Life magazine came along and photography surpassed illustration as the visual form that most people look to for information and entertainment. But the magazine in 1960, you told him that instead of doing genre scenes or scenes, anecdotal scenes of everyday life, that they just wanted portraits of celebrities. And you laughed. But it's interesting because that was sort of the beginning of celebrity culture. You know, I think, as I look back, because I think, you know, instead of following the travails of your next door neighbor and gossiping about the people in your town, you could follow the travails of Liz Taylor and Richard Burton. They were on the cover, suddenly, of every magazine. And he didn't like doing portraits. They wanted him to just do portraits. He did one of Bob Hope, went to LA to do that. But he hated doing portraits because he really saw himself as a storyteller. And he wasn't very good, I don't think, at doing portraits. He drew beautifully, he could do them, but it was no fun for him because he didn't get to use his imagination. And he never liked using famous models, even early on in his career, because he felt like you couldn't invent. You couldn't have Gary Cooper pose and then paint him in a way so that he wasn't recognizable as Gary Cooper. You're very limited as an artist if you're using a famous model. So he never really liked working with celebrities. And then, of course, the irony is the Post expected him to do nothing but paint celebrities, and it wasn't working out. And fortunately, he did get an offer from Look Magazine, at that point, to illustrate the civil rights movement, basically. Yes.
President Obama just gave out the Freedom Awards that Kennedy created. Was there any award that Roosevelt gave to him? Did he meet Rockwell? Did he acknowledge his help? Or Eleanor? Did either of them have any kind of interpersonal relationship with him?
Yes. I know that there was, I have a photograph of the event of the Four Freedom Show opening night in Washington, D.C., and both President Roosevelt and Eleanor attended. So they certainly met on that occasion. But I also know that that night Morgenthau was so annoyed that the U.S. government was joining with the Saturday Evening Post to do the Four Freedom Show that he left town. And his staff, he refused to meet Rockwell. He didn't want to meet anybody from the Post. And Rockwell did not have any kind of regular relationship with Roosevelt. Rockwell loved Eisenhower. That Eisenhower was his guy. They were really close in the 50s, and he went to the White House regularly and had dinner with Eisenhower. And it's interesting to me because Eisenhower also has kind of, his stock seems to be rising all the time. And you know, it's a very sensible. He was a sensible man, even though he was written off as you know, Mr. Boring for a long time. Everyone always says, "Oh, the conformist 50s." But lately, people have been revising their opinion on Eisenhower, and we see him as someone who was able to bring the country together. That act, which seems increasingly impossible in 21st century America. Yes.
My name is Barbara Spender. Just before we came here this evening, the Sotheby's catalog arrived in my email of the upcoming show, and there are several Rockwells, and the prices that are the estimates are really quite amazing. Do you want to say anything about that? How his stock seems to have risen.
It's true. It's true. The paintings do sell for a lot. I try to stay pure of the marketplace. And not pay too much attention to it. But just last night, a friend of mine was telling me that that's very naive. He said, you can't remain pure. You know, if you write about art, you have to pay attention to the marketplace and everything surrounding it. And this is a debate that critics have all the time, but I think it's very funny that my parents who are here actually are retired art dealers, and that is, and I'm an art critic. Well, I was in my youth. I think I still am. And that's one reason I always tried not to pay attention to the market, because it just was too easy, and I wanted to separate myself from that part of the art world. And the great irony is that the cover of my book has The Gossips, which is coming up for sale. And I was horrified. My editor is here, Eileen Smith. I said, you know, we thought this can't be. The painting was at the Rockwell Museum. How could this be at Sotheby's now? And I thought that was interesting. It's just a lesson to me that you can't really stay pure, and that Rockwell's market is increasing. I never really judge a painting, to put it mildly, on the basis of how much it commands at auction. The market is a critic, but I don't think it's a very good critic. And at the same time, I am glad to see the appreciation for Rockwell's work deepening across the board and not just in the academic community. Yes.
I'm sorry. Right after he died, the Curtis Publishing Company had a tremendous exhibit and films and all about him. It's surprising that he was fired by them, and yet they revered him. Obviously, he had some relationship with them all going after the layoff.
Not really. It's a complicated story, but if you read the chapter in the book, he was pretty much thrown out. People who worked in the building who were also fired, because there was a big turnover in staff at that point, a lot of them took the paintings, left, and owned the paintings. And I will tell you, I don't want to get into this in a big way, but the ones coming up for auction were taken from the building by the art director, Ken Stewart. They were not a gift from Rockwell. I have a letter in my papers from Ken Stewart complaining that Rockwell never gave him any art. But he took those paintings when he left the Post in 1962, The Gossip, Saying Grace, and Walking to Church. There have been lawsuits by people trying to, including one from Curtis Publications a while back, the Saturday Evening Post, which claimed that the paintings were theirs, they were in the building. And a court in Connecticut ruled that that he did own the paintings, because possession is 9/10 of the law. He's had them all these years. And now his children, he's no longer alive, Ken Stewart, his children are selling the paintings, which will probably fetch around $50 million. They've been at the Rockwell Museum for the past 18 years. The museum was paying all the insurance on them, and I was saddened that they didn't leave at least one picture at the museum, because I find it hard to believe that the paintings will even stay in the country. They may leave the country, which would be, I mean, who could afford to buy Saying Grace if it's going to be, I guess some people can. I mean, Steven Spielberg and George Lucas, who both collect his work, could afford to buy a $20 million painting. But we'll see what happens. Yes.
I'm Julie Morocco.
Hi, Julie Morocco.
Hi. Norman Rockwell was obviously very influenced by The Common Man, but can you talk a little bit about your research and finding any of his contemporaries in either political sphere or business that were of great influence to him?
His contemporaries in terms of artists?
Yes. Artists, business.
Who did he hang around with? He loved illustrators, and he loved the whole tradition of illustration. His hero was Howard Pyle, who illustrated Treasure Island and kind of invented the whole look of pirates that Hollywood still uses, pirates with scars on their head and rings in their ears. And he really believed that illustration was a way of bringing art to a mass audience. He was a true instinctive populist, somewhat like Walt Disney, who had no desire to have his work in museums, and or so he said. He certainly didn't go out of his way during his lifetime to get in good with art people. He was offered exhibitions at galleries that he turned down in the 30s and 40s, and his great inspiration, I would say, was other illustrators, both American, British, French, and also painting. I mean, I should add, he was a great student of art history. He studied at the Art Students League, same as Jackson Pollock and many other major figures in New York, and had a traditional art education, meaning he was taught to draw from the figure, which is the foundation of all art education, drew from plaster casts and then nudes. And he was a very talented figure artist. He really excelled at drawing the figure, never painted a landscape, tried abstraction, couldn't get into it. So he loved the figure, great figure painters of the past, from Rembrandt on down. Please.
I'm surprised to learn that he turned down exhibitions in his lifetime.
Mm-hmm. I was surprised, too, because I assumed when I started the book that I thought, oh, the art world snubbed him. He probably tried to get gallery shows and all that. It was not like that at all. He was really consumed by the idea of illustration and perfecting his work for the Saturday Evening Post. So much so that he lost money on those covers. You know, so the art world wrote him off as a commercial artist, but he really spent so much time on the covers that they drained him emotionally and financially, and he earned his money instead through advertising, by doing Kellogg's cereal boxes and tire advertisements and ads for all kinds of products. J. Walter Thompson was constantly knocking on his door, you know, pleading with him, please, please do the Green Giant corn niblets. There's a lot of correspondence like that in his archives. And he really was always running away from the advertisers, but finally took on a lot of that work in order to pay his very steep medical bills, and especially psychiatric bills.
And did he eventually have, if not a gallery showing, have there been major museum showings? And also, can you tell us something about his own museum in Massachusetts? I just learned from someone during the reception that Spielberg has endowed that. I was delighted to hear that. Can you tell us a little bit about that museum and any major shows he has had? And did he ever participate in those shows in any way?
There were some shows during his lifetime that he was completely uninterested in, and he was generally fairly uninterested in his own apotheosis. He was, like many artists, you know, his idea of a great reward was a great morning's work, and did not pay a lot of attention to all the stuff swirling outside his studio. The Rockwell Museum, I'm just so glad it's there, because it was basically started by his third wife, Molly Rockwell, an interesting New Englander, born in Stockbridge, one of the first women to graduate from, no, I always told you she was one of the first women to graduate from Radcliffe, but she couldn't have been, because she graduated in 1919, and I'm sure the school goes way back. But anyway, she decided to start the museum. He didn't care. He couldn't be bothered with it. And it's a good thing she did that, because at the time of his death, his paintings were not collected by museums. And I don't know where they would be now. You know, you'd be seeing them on, what, is Antiques Roadshow? Is that the... They would be, you know, people would be pulling them out of attics, and some of them would have been discarded, probably. A lot of art have been lost. So the museum, I think, is great because it has the bulk of his work, and it has all of his papers, almost all of his papers, and it provides a place for us to go and study the work, enjoy it, but also to study it as taste changes from one decade to the next. And it's great that it's there. It's self-supporting. It's not supported by the family or the estate. They raise all their money through admission revenue. And it's very well managed. Some very fine people working there. No, he hasn't endowed it at all. He is a trustee of the museum. He's on the board. And he has an enormous collection of Rockwells. And the other person who has an enormous collection is his pal, George Lucas. And George Lucas is now in the process of building his own museum of illustration, and I interviewed him recently for a piece in the Times, and I said, why don't you give your collection to the Rockwell Museum? Why do you have to start a separate museum of illustration? And he said, well, he said, they just don't have the facilities to manage it. I said, so build them. I mean, I think it's okay if he wants to keep his work on the West Coast. I have no problem with that. But the Rockwell Museum is devoted not only to Rockwell, but to the history of illustration. And in that sense, I think it's really going to do well in the future, because there is a growing interest in work outside the art historical canon, obviously. One more, should we take one more? I have no idea what time it is. Two more, okay. Yes.
My name is Maruta Friedler, and I gather from what you said that he didn't have any typical heirs. Did he have children?
Because
he didn't leave.
That's a very complicated question. He has three sons. And what he left, okay, so you're thinking those poor boys, they didn't get any paintings, and now these pictures are coming up at auction for $50 million. He has three sons. They're about 80, early 80s now. They're all lovely people, artistically inclined and very low-key. And what he left them is the copyright on his work, because at the time that was more valuable. Licensing fees were more valuable than the paintings themselves. So anytime a painting is reproduced, if you see a Rockwell in a TV commercial, that kind of thing, the money goes to the family. And it's been a good source of income. I have no idea how much, but I think they're well provided for, fortunately.
Did they get into any fights about the paintings themselves?
Well, it's funny. They're exactly like their dad. I just had dinner with Jarvis Rockwell, their oldest son, recently, and I said, you know, I don't understand. Why don't you sue Ken Stewart's children and get that painting, meaning saying grace? You know, the one that Ken Stewart took from the Post. And I said, don't you want that? And he said, oh, please. I had enough of my father. You know, they just, he's an artist himself. They just, you know, they have a fabulous attitude, basically. They're not embittered by this. And I think part of it is also that he was difficult as a father, and they're all creative people. So if you're a creative person and you have an artist father who's not that nurturing, you spend your whole life trying to develop your own voice and your own work and your own confidence, and that has been their lifelong struggle in all three cases. So the last thing they want to think about is suing to get possession.
What about
possession.
His parents, and were they involved with art, or
his parents? His parents,
yes.
No, not particularly. But he had a grandfather. I opened the book with a grandfather named Howard Hill, who was a 19th century American artist who met a really disastrous end, and who, like Rockwell, had a fabulous talent for very precise, realistic, detail-laden drawing. A tradition that probably comes out of engraving in England. His ancestors were English. But so there were some artistic genes in the family, certainly. Okay. What are we doing? Yes.
I don't want to end on a bad note, but you mentioned that he spent a lot of money on his psychiatrist. Could you give us a little hint of that?
No, it's not a bad note. It's a good note, because his shrink was Eric Erickson, who was one of the great intellectuals and psychoanalysts of the 20th century. I can tell from the sigh that just went up in this room that you all hold him in high regard. And he was in Stockbridge because he was at the Austin Rigg Center, and Rockwell was there, and they formed a relationship that was probably the most constructive relationship of Rockwell's life. And it's really a pretty inspiring story. It's not a downer. Erickson really helped him. He was a very needy person who needed a lot of support and who found that support in Erickson. And I think Erickson helped liberate him to do his later civil rights work and to leave the Post and put that behind him very quickly and get on to other things. Okay, well, thank you all. Thank you all. Happy Thanksgiving, everybody.
Yes, Thank you. And Deborah will be signing books upstairs. And thank you, Deborah Solomon. Thank you very much.